Welcome everybody to the video, and this is a call to the whole world for worldwide repentance, entering into the mood of repentance. Repentance is a mood, okay? When we look at the world, what are we looking at? All these mood enhancers in the world, actually, right? If you look at that, it's this struggle in the world about mood. What I'm saying is the mood of repentance is what actually is best for you. And the world is saying, no. The mood of frivolity and in the flesh, you know, indulge in the flesh, hedonism, the mood of hedonism, the world says, that's what is best for you. They're wrong. They're absolutely wrong about that. I'll tell you why. The mood of repentance actually is based upon absorbing the shock of incredible good fortune. Whereas the mood of hedonism is to say that we don't have any good fortune. There is no good fortune to be had. So let's just try to, you know, party as much as we can and grab whatever crumbs we can and make the best of it. That's hedonism. Mood of repentance is you're actually absorbing tremendous great news, tremendous great fortune, actually. You say, well, what do you mean? Well, just for instance, yesterday, I saw very clearly that this entire birth, aging, death thing is totally unnecessary. At every single point along the way is completely unnecessary. How about that for great good news? Literally saw it. I said, this is just a dream. It really is. And that's like stunning, right? Because you say, oh my gosh. Every bit of suffering I've ever undergone is actually totally unnecessary, and I can see that I'm going to get free of it. So how is that great and stunning great news? Now, you might think if you get stunningly great news that you're going to be running around, shouting, going to the bar, drinking, say, hey, everybody, I'm so, you know. No, because it's very stunning. It's very sobering. It's very sobering because it's a radical departure from your expectations in the future. In other words, your expectations of the future are suddenly very much changed. And it is overwhelming. It's like a feeling of being overwhelmed such that you need to manage this. So the whole thing about the mood of repentance, which religion is supposed to provide support system for, is that there's this recognition that you need some time and some space to quietly absorb this, and you need to manage it wisely so you don't go jump into hedonism after you realize this. You absorb it and you're able to remain calm, quiet, subdued, sober. It's a vast upheaval in your system when you see great good fortune, because we really, hedonism, the secular humanistic hedonism, does not see any vast great fortune in your future at all. It just sees more of these things, okay? More of these things. More things. You can change your decor every week, maybe, or something, but still more frantic action, more desperate struggle, more trying to get more. Yeah, it's really a very doomy kind of future going with hedonism. And of course, when you look at the future and you see all this, you know, oh God, up there it's just terrible, you feel like you want to party right now. Whereas with repentance, the mood of repentance, you look up the future and say, oh my gosh, I have a completely glorious future. So I don't need to be partying now or, you know, try to act out. No, it's right there. I'm moving towards this. Let's be serious about this. Let's be very serious. Let me adjust to this. I want to adjust. I want to, you know, so it brings a somber, serious, focused attitude to the situation. That's called the mood of repentance. It's a mood. The world is all about these moods in television, media, entertainment. The whole secular hedonistic antichrist movement is got all these vast mood enhancers, the pharmaceutical situation, etc. You know, enhance your mood, you know, just take these pills, just watch this, you know, and use these drugs and watch this entertainment, all this stuff. It's a live for now, because tomorrow you die, you know. Okay, so the Titanic, these people are just, you know, the closer the ship got to the iceberg, the more the gambling and the boozing and the partying went on, and this whole hedonistic thing just got more and more intense. Whereas maybe there's some people out on the deck saying, hey, you know, what are these things? Oh, they're lifeboats. I wonder if these lifeboats work. How do these lifeboats work? Oh, okay. See, you know. And so, oh, boom, what happened? Oh, we hit something? Wow, maybe we better take a look at these lifeboats. Maybe we better drop the lifeboats, you know. Maybe we better get in the lifeboats. Maybe we better try to, you know, save people. So, different mood. They're not in there, you know, trying to lose their minds through partying. Like, say, oh, we're going to die soon, so we might as well just get into this, you know, giddy state. Sort of pre-sacrificial state. Hedonism always is aiming at this pre-sacrificial state, because sacrifice is always in its future. So, but, and of course it demonizes repentance. Oh, you guys are not, you know, no fun. It's actually quite a bit of fun to realize just how free you really are. You know, these cage-free chickens that they say, cage-free chickens, well, they raise them up to a certain age caged, and then they start laying eggs, whatever, but then they're supposed to be cage-free. They open the door of the cage, but the chickens never go out. They never go out. So they call them cage-free, but they might as well have the door closed. So we are, when we see our freedom, you know, we're like those chickens in a cage, and we say, wow, I don't know. The door's open. You know, really what it is like the chickens are looking at the door and say, my gosh, there's no door there. And then they say, there's never been a door there, actually. That's where the analogy breaks down. But there's never been a door there. There's been an imaginary door. And ultimately the chicken realizes it's never been a cage, but that's too much for the chicken. So we're only aimed at getting out that door, actually. Okay, ultimately, there's never been any door, there's never been any cage, there's never been any chicken, ultimately, but for our purposes, for practical, pragmatic purposes, we'll say there's no door there, there's never been a door. So the chicken now has to, you know, poke its head out, you know, it's very serious, it's kind of frightened, like, wow, what is this place outside, I don't know this place. So it's a kind of a somber, focus, a little bit worrisome mood when the chicken says, hey, I think I can leave this cage. I think I can get out and maybe I'll feel better. I don't know, but, you know, I never walked around before, you know, that kind of stuff. So it's a sober thing. When you begin to realize your freedom, it automatically you just say, uh-oh, wow. This is serious. It's really serious, yeah. When you see how free you actually are, it's serious. You say, holy cow, this is a serious issue. It's a positive one, but it's still very serious, because you say, how in the world am I going to, you know, deal with this? My gosh. So the mood of repentance comes to those who have glimpsed their freedom. And I'm just encouraging everyone to remain as much as possible in that mood of repentance. It's not, you know, most of the time in the daytime we're doing all sorts of stuff, and but you have to have some time where you really get into this very focused attitude. Now, when you do this, what happens is insights, you see more freedom. I've been seeing so much freedom, it's just like, holy cow, I don't even know how to explain it. This morning, the same thing. I mean, just massive amount of insight, fundamental insight, and it's just like, wow, I'm really seeing the stuff that you're supposed to see. And that, so it gives me pause here to just slow down. You know, slow down, breathe, slow down and breathe. Don't be thinking about action. Forget about action. The action is all going on in the clarification. That's where the action really is. Tremendous action there. It's like the eye. The eye says to us, can you please flatten spaciousness so I can understand it? that's what this morning, that's what the eye, I saw the eye say that. That's what the eye says to us. Can you please flatten spaciousness so I can understand it? And then I began to kind of work, deconstruct this whole thing and open it up to spaciousness. And then I got to the point where I realized that well, I'm going to see a perceptual change and I won't see thingness. And I said, everything's going to be ruined. Everything, which is true, everything is going to be ruined. But that's a negative way of putting it. In other words, you no longer will see things the way that we've been seeing them, flat, without spaciousness, as if the thing is somehow separate from the spaciousness of the thing. And that is going to come to an end. In other words, so the seeing of things will come to an end. It'll be ruined. Won't be the same. And so I'm all kind of like mopey, or some of the ego's mopey about that. Like, wow. Very intense kind of realization. And so that brings, you know, Buddha repentance. It hits hard in your gut, in your system. It's like, oh my gosh, everything's going to be ruined. But actually, not ruined is not quite the right way. There's one way of looking at it. Meaning, I won't see it the way I saw it before. I realized that they're not really things at all. They're not really the flat. There's no more flatness. There's no more absence of spaciousness. But first comes sort of this in-between state where it's not pure spaciousness. You're not quite aware of just pure spaciousness everywhere, but you are aware that there is no flatness. You see, the I thought, which is the first thought, is a thought of flatness. It's a thought of no spaciousness. It's a thought that's designed to be prior to spaciousness, so therefore separate from it. Not the idea is that the thought is that spaciousness is contained within flatness. So the I, the ego, we imagine that to be prior to God, prior to pure spaciousness, prior to that. And our seeing things, our perception of all these things, we say, well, you know, this is our world, our creation, and then so spaciousness, it is around that, but it's not, you know, the spaciousness is not prior, all this stuff is not arising in spaciousness, the spaciousness is arising from all these things, so to speak. It's a crazy, ridiculous position. So imagine being asked, can you flatten spaciousness so I can understand it? That's what the ego wants us to do. That's what the I wants us to do. The I is just a thought in spaciousness, but it's a thought of flatness. But is a thought of flatness actually flat? Or is it abiding in spaciousness, you see? That's the question. It's still abiding in spaciousness. All thoughts do. Even a thought of flatness is abiding in spaciousness. So, it's when you work at clarification, you're going to get past obstacles, and then you're going to go into new territory, and you say, uh-oh. I better, you know, be very alert and aware here. So you cannot be all distracted by the whole frivolous party scene that's going on in the world. And I know that there are many agents of flatness, the idea of the flatness, the I, the ego, who are in this world now relentlessly provoking people to party. They say, come on, let's party. Come on, let's party. Come on, let's go, man. You know, come on, get off your sofa. Drag yourself over here. Gotta party more. Come on. Massive armada of these agents are in the world. Very toxic people, actually. Very toxic attitude. Super toxic. It's the opposite of what you need to do. So you have to let the Holy Spirit make excuses for you and arrange your life so that you avoid that kind of stuff. Otherwise, you'll say, well, I got nothing better to do. I mean, I'll just sit here and do nothing. I might as well go out and have a great time and waste my life. So what you have to do is you have to start getting a hold of various books, tapes, videos, insights, meditation, contemplation, whatever you can do to start getting glimpses of your freedom. And then when you do, you'll start becoming sober and saying, oh, well, wait a minute. I need to pay a little more attention to this. This is significant. This is very significant. And as you go along, at some point, like where I'm at, the significance is so incredible. But at this point, I'm able to deal with it just as I dealt with other insights, lesser ones earlier on. It's just more, you know, just more like, wow. But it's really very significant. And then you just give it time, give it attention. The dance of distraction in this world, you know, is nothing but a pre-sacrificial diversion. You know, it's just, it's got nothing for you. Nothing for you. What is your future when you do that? Nothing, really. You'll actually think that you, you know, you just dwell in flat land and then you get completely flattened by death. And the whole thing can be seen through. I guarantee you the entire situation can be leveled as far as its transparency. Transparency, it can become completely transparent. And then you say, uh-oh, wow. None of this is true. It's just all this ridiculous farce. It's a complete dream. Oh, well. What's next? You know, you think, what's next? If that's the thing, what's next? So you're sober. What's next? I need to be sober. Maybe I'll get even more freedom next. I better be, you know, ready for that freedom. So the path demands this kind of sobriety. There's no way you can try to have it both ways. You might as well, that's the thing, you might as well just decide, okay, let me put the time in with this sobriety and mood of repentance. Let me put the time in there. And the other stuff, you know, let me at least do that. Let me at least do that. You know, it's not like you have to make some choice, definitive choice, like this is all I'm going to do forever. No, it's not like that. It's day by day, just this day, say at least this day, my efforts are really going to be towards the mood of repentance, at least this day. And just do it one day at a time. That's all I've ever done, one day at a time. I haven't made any commitments, I'm going to do this for the rest of my life, whatever. Not one day at a time. It's today, this is what I'm going to do. This hour, that's what I'm going to do. You just make small steps, but consistently. The next day, you say, hey, I can do it, I'm going to do it again. So the core, the very core of the teachings can be seen. It can be seen. Like Ramana said, Ramana Maharshi said, look, you know, what's the origin of the I thought? Look at the I thought. You can look at that very simply. I never understood what he was talking about, but now I do. And it's a thought of flatness, a thought of pre-spaciousness. Just a thought. It's a thought that is the beginning of a supposed new creation, the flatness within which all flatness arises. In other words, the thoughtness within which all beliefs of flat, the flatness within which all beliefs of flatness are appearing in is the I. So in other words, the I is like supposedly the ground of being of a new creation, of some separate creation. So we're told that we are serving the I, or I am this, I am flatness, you know. But the I is really like a god of our own, you know, belief. Yeah, but it's just a thought. It's just within the spaciousness. Can you see the I thought dwelling within the spaciousness? It is the question. And when you're able to do that, you know, this change is like, wow, this is a lot of realization. A lot of realization is there. Because if the I thought is dwelling in the spaciousness, then every other thought is also, you see. That's the key thought, he said, as Armana said, that's the key thought. The key thought, the I thought, once you recognize that, all the other thoughts then go with it, he says. Once that spell is broken, all other thoughts are also seen in spaciousness automatically. So he said that's the shortcut, that's the fast way, if you can do it. it's been... long road for me, for sure. I didn't go at it directly at all, because I'm not able to do that yet. I have to, you know, you have to get a context for it, actually. And you have to be very sober now. You're dwelling in a culture that's not a sober culture. I was at the local drugstore yesterday, a CVS store, and I've been there, you know, quite a few times over the years, and getting just household stuff. And I always noticed there are these people who come in, so about half the people, it seems like, come in there and are just loading up on hard alcohol. Bottles and bottles and bottles of big bottles of, you know, hard alcohol. As I look at these people and I say, oh my gosh, they're raving alcoholics. And most of them are housewives. Most of them are women, actually. And they're very nice and dressed. They're trying, you know, very try to svelte and dress nicely, but look at their face, and it's just like they're falling apart. They're rotting. You know, this alcohol's killing them. They're poisoning themselves. And of course, we just go off the cash register. Yeah, everything's fine. You can just come out with this, you know, armful of hard alcohol. I said, my God, that's so. You can avoid that by entering into the mood of repentance. You don't need the alcohol, because the realizations you have are way more shocking than getting drunk, you know, way more. As far as like getting your attention, it's like, wow, this is like incredible. Better than drugs, better than all, you know, anything really. It's just like, whoa, maybe I can be free. I don't know, maybe my future is not, you know, so terrible. Maybe I can, you know, that kind of thing. So it's like, it's like someone who has no air suddenly getting a breath of air, kind of thing. But these poor people, they have no breath of air, and they just, you know, thinking they're just gonna drink themselves to death. So it's happening all around us right now. Is there are a tremendous number of people who are just drinking themselves to death, actually. And God, you know, wow, their face, they try to smear on the makeup and everything, and these are like middle-aged women, so many, and some men too, and some younger people, I can just tell, they just drink like fish, and it's just destroying them. This is, you know, the mood of this country is giving no support, and this world is giving no support to people to, you know, brave it out and actually turn towards the mood of repentance. And no support to it. These people are just getting absolutely, you know, injected with IVs full of this frivolity, hedonistic attitude and everything. And they think like, hey, this is what I'm supposed to be doing. I'm supposed to be having fun, but I don't really feel like having fun. There's something wrong with me. I need this drink so I can have fun. I can be fun. You can see the sadness on these people's faces. It's just, you know, they're like in dismay. They're, you know, they try to paint a happy facade on, and you can see past that, and they're just like in agony. These people are in agony. Because they've never been given permission to get serious, actually, about their freedom. They feel that society doesn't give permission to get serious about their liberation from delusion. And it doesn't. The society we live in now is, You can't even, really shouldn't even, even try and put any words on it. It's that terrible. It's that self-important and terrible that it doesn't give people any room to breathe as far as, you know, permission. No permission at all. There's no permission coming from this world. That's the problem. And this world demonizes anybody who gives others permission. Say, hey, I give you permission, full permission to enter into the mood of repentance. Let's do it. Let's, you know, they say, oh, you're crazy. No, we don't give you that permission. So it's just this horrible death spiral the world is in, actually. And the older men are having just incredible blitzkrieg. It's been going for so long, of testosterone supplements. Incredible blitzkrieg. It's been going on for decades, but it's building more and more and more. Saturation, super saturation. Anything on radio or television or newspaper or magazine that has to do with men, you know, middle-aged men who are getting older, who are interested in that, like Golf magazine, for instance, Friends Golf, saturated with ads about testosterone supplements and alcohol and all these mood enhancers, okay, all right. And now they're saying, well, yeah, well, their studies are showing that actually it causes heart attacks, strokes, can be very dangerous for older men. That's never, you know, that's never brought to light. That's just an example. The world is absolutely saturated with this attitude, and it's a drugged world. I think in Jesus said that in the Bible, it says the correct interpretation is the Antichrist, so to speak, will be known through because of the pharmaceutical nature. The whole world will be like a great pharmacy. People will be addicted to pharmaceuticals and mood agents. We're there. We're already there. And the people are like prisoners of this. And it's going to get much, 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 much worse. They're now basically pushing legalization of pot, you know, that's going to be spreading out through Western countries, you know, just like a juggernaut type of thing. And it's just like, let's legalize this, let's legalize this, let's legalize this. Prostitution will probably be legalized. They'll say, let's just have pure hedonism. What the heck? that's where it's going, actually. And those who, you know, oppose that say, whoa, that's not how you get to freedom. You have to spend time in this mood of repentance. You have to spend your life really absorbing the shock of your good, great, and glorious good fortune. Otherwise, you will remain in a severely deluded condition. Those voices are being drowned out. So it means the world's headed towards a place where severe delusion is demanded of everybody. That's why I call on the great spiritual teacher, say, help, 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 come on, what are you waiting for? There's nothing to wait for. This is a crisis. Now, do we really have to wait for the pictures of the devastation and the crisis before we do anything? That's what bothers me so much. I've been calling out for help my whole life, saying, this is coming, this is coming, this is coming. We need help, help, help. Don't wait until it's too late. Don't wait until the typhoon annihilates, you know, the countryside and cities, etc., just, you know, lays complete waste to everything. Get help in place first. Get an infrastructure of help in place and get people educated, you know, get supply, you know, that kind of thing. Don't wait. Be proactive in what you're doing. Because the crisis is on us, and it's like the typhoon is like just right off the coast of the Philippines, you know, and the winds are 190 miles an hour. You really have to wait and see what happens before you realize, hey, this is going to be a disaster. Of course not. Only an absolute fool would only whimsicality would think that way. Because there's no reasoning that could lead to that conclusion at all. So it must be whim. The world runs on whim, okay? It runs on whim. And they say, look, after the fact, they say, oh, gee, gosh, wow, look at all the devastation. How awful. What do we do? What do we do? What do we do? You know? Well, for one thing, if you saw something like that coming, you would have a chance to get out of harm's way, right? If people said, folks, look, it's going to be complete devastation soon. 190 mile hour winds, 15 foot surge, sea surge. You know, why don't you go stay with your relatives in some other place? You know, give pack up your things and get out of harm's way. But instead, no, they wait until late afterwards and say, oh gosh, what a terrible typhoon, awful. And this is the human nature. This is human nature. We tend not to prepare for severe crises, hoping that it won't happen. What we think is, if I don't prepare, it won't happen. God won't let it happen because I'm not prepared. That's the psych. We use reverse psychology, and it doesn't work. So here's this huge typhoon coming in towards Samar and Leyte and Cebu and Negros and that whole area, the middle area of the Philippine archipelago, and people are saying, yeah, here it comes, it's getting close, and they say, well, we're not doing a darn thing about it. We're just going to go on just like nothing's going to happen, and therefore, it won't happen. Since we're not prepared, it can't happen. Guess what? Doesn't work out very well. That's what people do. So in this world, I find so many people simply saying, you know what, if we just don't take any steps at all, maybe it won't happen, this problem, we'll just, you know, Peter, dissipate, it won't happen. Maybe we just appease, you know, appeasement. It's like in Nazi Germany, the Neville Chamberlain, appease. That won't happen. Don't worry, folks. We're friends. We're friends with Hitler. Everything's fine. We'll appease. All the countries kept appeasing, hoping it wouldn't happen. Hoping. Look what happened. So it's whimsicality to take a position of, no, I'm just going to keep ignoring it, and I'm so superior that nothing's going to happen. The only way that nothing can happen is the realization there are no things. But people don't have that realization. So they say, yeah, all this is flat, there are things, the whole delusional system's there, but they expect no effects from it. It's impossible. The right way is to realize, see as all a dream, and then from that standpoint, nothing really can happen at all, not to you at all. And actually, from that position, miracles are absolutely totally in play. It's like a waking dream. You know it's a dream, then you know there are no laws or forces or anything like that, right? If you realize you're the dreamer of the dream, how can there be actual laws and forces that you must obey in the dream? There aren't any. So, I mean, sure, a storm could be bearing down and on you, for instance, and you just realize nothing is happening. It's a dream, and decide, I'm just going to have it calm instead, and then be calm. It's just a dream. So, yeah, some spiritual masters can do these types of miracles, but you cannot... Don't count on that sort of stuff until you actually realize all this. So don't try to be going out being a wonder worker. That's not the point of it all. What we need to do is be in the mood of repentance, okay? And that will enable us eventually to realize this. And then you'll see that you really cannot interfere with what takes place, because then people would just get even more messed up and say, hey, there is a way to flatten spaciousness. You know, they will misinterpret it, etc. So, working wonders and all that kind of, forget it. It's a waste of time. Don't pursue it. I don't know any teachers that have said pursue that. What all teachers say is pursuing this mood of repentance. Absolutely. Just being it. Give yourself the opportunity for great clarity to arise, great good fortune to be seen. Which is stunning. I mean, it's stunning. When you see great good fortune in your life, you say, "Oh my gosh, this is what I'm going to have." You say, you just are bowled over by it because you say, "I thought I was going to have just an endless, you know, suffering and death and misery and aging and forgetfulness, and I thought I was going to have vulnerability and frailty, and I thought I was going to be lonely and desperate and separate. I thought I was going to be this, you know, on and on and on, depressed forever, tired forever, and now I see that's all going to fade away like a mirage." You know, how do you cope with this? It's almost like survivor guilt, you know. It's like that, almost, really. Survivor guilt, yeah, I've had a lot of that. I feel so terrible for all the people, you know, who are still stuck in this crazy dream, thinking it has power over them. That dream of flatness, thinking that they're dwelling in the land of flatness, not realizing that all this is just merely thoughts, bubbles in spaciousness, not seeing that. They don't see it. So they continue to go down to the drugstore and stock up on booze and drink themselves into a stupor. What can you do? Do you turn the booze into water for them? They'll get really angry. You know, attack you for that. They'll be so upset. They think, "Oh, you're forcing me to face an impossible future with no crutch at all. How terrible of you." So, but the best advice is for everyone to enter into this mood of repentance, for that to be enculturated. That it is absolutely essential to be enculturated. And what we're getting now in the world is the opposite of that, which I say the world is Antichrist. And they told Jesus, they asked Jesus when he's leaving, "Why are you leaving?" I said, "Well, what are you doing? Why are you leaving your kingdom?" Jesus said, "This is not my kingdom." "What are you talking about? This place is the kingdom of darkness. This is the evil, you know, the prince of darkness. This is its kingdom. It's not my kingdom. I'm going to my Father's kingdom," he said. So this world here, especially now, we're seeing is under the spell of the Antichrist, absolutely. It's against your freedom. It's against realizing spaciousness. So instead of enculturating a mood of repentance in the family, children, you know, from everybody, family, neighbors, neighborhood, schools, town, community, town, etc., city, county, state, country, world. Instead of enculturating this mood of repentance from cradle to grave, which is what we're supposed to be doing. Otherwise, how can we realize our great good fortune? There's no other way. You cannot go from the mood we're in now, which is just a sense of total, we're going to be totally annihilated, total flatness. We have no hope, real hope at all. You know, we're just animals. And to go from that to the great good fortune that you're really spirit, and none of this ever took place, there's never been any flatness, ever. It is a gigantic leap. And so you need to bridge that gap there, the continuity gap, through this mood of repentance. That is the actual way that you practice, and gradually you bridge it more and more and more until you come to the point where you can accept this no-thingness, the vision of no-thingness, where all things have a spacious component to them. So in other words, you don't see any flatness at all. That's the intermediate step, vision of Christ, the seamlessness of spaciousness. Everything seems to be enveloped in this sense of spaciousness, but you're not yet recognizing that everything is nothing but pure spaciousness. The whole, it's all that way. That's beyond what we need to worry about. But instead of getting that in the world now, we're getting this acculturation. We've already gotten it. the PlayStation thing, the super violent action video games that are just like all the super stuff that's the opposite. Antichrist, opposite. Antichrist means opposite of what you should be doing. That goes on in every household, almost every household, almost every our neighbors, our community, our town, our city, our county, our state, our country, our world. It goes on through and through all of that now. And then people walking around, they're playing the games on their smartphones, right? Their dumb phones and their tablets. And it's nonstop. How often do you see somebody, for instance, just sitting there like this? Serious, composed, reflective, calm, inner-directed, spending 2 minutes that way, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, half an hour, 2 hours. How often do you see that? I haven't seen anyone out as I go driving around all the time. I never see it. Even in church, people are not that way, really. They're just there, they're putting in the time, and okay, And even when people want to do that, say, oh, well, let's take a hike. And so you're busy hiking. You might see a view. Oh, isn't that a nice view? Then you're hiking, exercising. No, they're not. How about just sitting where you are, sitting quietly, reflecting, and not necessarily using your eyesight as far as trying to see something, some beautiful flatness, some beautiful form of flatness. Let your senses become more diffuse. You're not trying to get anything through your senses so much. Minimal. If you're hearing this video, you're seeing, hearing, but you don't really have to be like laser focused or something. It just can kind of diffusely flow in. And you're really more focused on your internal, the internal dynamic of what's really going on. What's really going on? And keep trying to focus on that and sort it out and take a look at it. And call to mind the sense that you are actually not as imprisoned as you think you are. You're actually, you know, things are way better actually. You just can't quite accept it. And you're working on this mood of acceptance. That's what has to be done. It has to be done. There's no other way. The other way leads to you popping pills and drinking booze, and eventually it just, you know, absolutely the wheels come off. You got no good habits. So the youth has been taught last 3 or 4 generations of bad habits, extremely bad habits. And it's showing up more and more and more and more and more and more. Sure, we can disguise it by doing all sorts of charity work and active work and stuff like that. That's not what's needed. Primarily, you can also do that, but the underlying habit of mind is this mood of repentance. That has to be primary. And then on top of that, you can live your life and help people out if you want. You do your job, help people out, etc. But every moment that's free and you get into that mood of repentance right away, you don't waste time with other stuff. And then you make progress. You don't have to lock yourself away in a monastic cell. You can if you want to, but you don't have to. All right. One of our job sites just got robbed and broken in and locked, smashed, and everything. So it just shows you the mood of people. Now they're desperate for things. If you have a mood of repentance, You're not so desperate for things, because you can spend your time, you know, just being quiet like this. Whereas if you don't have this, you're saying, you know, what do I do? I gotta go somewhere. I gotta do something. I gotta get something. I gotta be happy. I gotta find happiness. I don't know where it is. I need all these things to help me search. And, you know, I need to search. I need money. I got to go search. Maybe it's there. I got to do this. I got to find this person, that person. Whereas if you realize that your freedom is already, you already are free. It's just that you got to get over the shock of that realization. Then you won't be so susceptible to all that materialism and stuff. Jesus said the kingdom of heaven is within. In other words, we're already, he says closer than close. What is closer than close? Spaciousness, pure spaciousness. Everything is already within pure spaciousness. So this realization is within, well, it's everywhere. So you're not, there's not some flatness anywhere, actually. There's no flatness anywhere. There's never been. And see, that's a shock. Because perceptually, we think we're seeing flatness. And then to hear, there's no flatness anywhere. It stuns. I'm feeling it right now. It's stunning. There's no flatness anywhere. Never been any flatness. Meaning absence of spaciousness. Or absence of absence. Pure absence is same as pure spaciousness. Because this runs counter to our perception, doesn't it? We think we're perceiving flatness. We've been thinking this all along. But we're perceiving something that isn't there. The flatness is actually not the case. That's why Jesus says we're hallucinating. We think we're seeing flatness. There is no flatness anywhere. Meaning, absence of any spaciousness. Some point where is it, where there's no spaciousness. There is none. Never been. So our whole system is perception and thinking and hallucinating there's this flatness, and then we're telling ourselves that there is no flatness there. And of course this causes a shake-up in our system, like what? And that's where you have to get this calmness. The mood of repentance enables these insights to happen. It's an enabler. It's the ultimate enabler. So that's the answer. Why are these churches, places of worship, or whatever do we call them, go there? Places, your meditation places. Why do people go there? They're quiet, they're meditative, they're reflective, they're somber, they're focused. People say, why aren't you? Why aren't you out sailing or something? Come on, having a party on a yacht somewhere. Because this enables these insights to happen. It's an enabler. In some ways, you could call it, quote-unquote, the ultimate drug, in that it enables this realization to take place, that there is no flatness. There's never been. I was just hallucinating. Now, the first step out of that hallucination, or the intermediate step, would be to see all forms of what I thought were flatness, now having the sense of spaciousness about them. And yet still, you can still perceive the form. This is that form. So it's sort of like the form is there, but it's emanating the sense of spaciousness. Emanating some sense of this, right? It's just like, and then that's what we're aiming for, something along those lines. And the mood of repentance enables one to see this and recognize it. It's like, I see that. Very sober. And it's not a mentally acute thing at all. So it's different. It's not like a speedy thing, you know, speedy and mental acuity stuff, no. Because that's actually an attempt to get a sense of spaciousness by the mind, all these thoughts moving. Like, we can get some sort of sense of happiness within this hallucination of flatness if we just have all our thoughts going, moving really rapidly. And computers, same thing. No, that's not it at all. The sense of spaciousness is everywhere right now. There's nothing needs to happen thought-wise for it, you see. Thoughts can still be there, but they also have a sense of spaciousness to them. Everything, thoughts, what you're perceiving out there. Actually, we're perceiving our thoughts. Otherwise, how would we be aware of them if we weren't perceiving them? That's why people say, oh yeah, I see that. In other words, I see that thought. Yeah. All right. So, this is just, it's the ultimate drugs, the ultimate enabler. You might say, the ultimate enabler is this, enables us to accept our incredible good fortune that we've never been in Flatland. There is no Flatland. There is no Flatland. And that's the realization that will dawn on us when we have prepared ourselves for it. And, you know, it's just, we can't even, and then again, the ego says, well, could you flatten that out for me so I can understand it? Don't try to answer that, yes or no. Just notice the question. When you get a real terrible question like this, just notice it. Don't struggle with it right off. Just notice it. And then you'll laugh about it. Could you flatten out the sense of spaciousness for me so I could understand it? Understand means prior to it. Can you, was really saying, can you please realize that I'm prior to that? That's what it's really saying, right? Could you please realize that I am prior to that? Could you please pay attention to what I'm telling you, that I'm prior to that, that I'm flat? Could you please come out of that hallucination of spaciousness and get back into reality of flatness? That's what the ego's really saying, isn't it? You say, no. I don't know what you'd say, but just look at it like that. See what it's really saying. It's a demand. Could you please, I'm demanding that you do this, that you stop wasting time with this total ridiculous hallucination of spaciousness, because that is just a dead end. That's what the ego says. Ruination of all things, at the end of all things, is when you see the sense of spaciousness of all things, because from the ego standpoint, that means there are no more things. See, ego standpoint, things are flat. They don't have any intrinsic spaciousness, not abiding in spaciousness. First the thing comes, and there's time, and then the spaciousness. So the ego will say, that's the end of everything. Everything is the end of everything. End of the world. Yeah, it is, according to the ego. But it's not for us. It's just according to the hallucination. It's the end of a hallucination, basically. It's the end of my hallucination of a flat world. Yeah, well, of flatness. And it's the end of my hallucination of things. Yeah, it is. So, again, mood of repentance enables one to soberly look at this, because we've been hallucinating for so long, it's tough for us to set it down. Come to an end. It's the end of hallucination. Wow. Actually, it's not, because even the sense of spaciousness is around everything within emanating is still hallucination. But it's the one hallucination that frees us from all hallucination. So then the ego will say it. The ego will say, no, I want something better. I want an hallucination right now, forever. And then maybe it's like saying, I'm so disappointed, depressed that you're going to have another hallucination. I thought you wanted to end it. I'm so disappointed for you. How awful. You know, it plays that card. So This is what you get. You can see what's going on when you're in the mood of repentance. When you're not, how much clarity do you get? Just ask yourself. When you're out shopping in a mall, wow, look at these shoes. Oh, look at that stuff. Oh my gosh. Yeah, I kind of like this. I want to get that. How much do you really are able to really peel back the layers, the intrinsic, inherent, deep core stuff, and say, ah, and get the sense of I'm getting free of that? How much? Just ask yourself that question. Now, of course, there's so much stuff to go shopping for, and so many shopping centers, and they're changing the merchandise so quickly that you feel if you don't get out there all the time, you're going to miss so much stuff, right? So it's an enormous problem, catastrophic problem. We I say there's a catastrophe in the world. People say, what are you talking about? Everything seems to be not so bad. Well, we got the bad typhoon or earthquakes, tsunamis, whatever. But no, the catastrophe is all this hedonistic materialism. That's the catastrophe. Because you're getting pulled away from what helps you. And you go out there shopping. Yeah, I'm going to shop here. I'm going to shop online. I'm going to shop. Always looking at stuff to buy, places to go, things to do, people to talk to, people, things to tweet, on and on. When do you spend time in this type of reflection here, mood of repentance? You don't. And then you realize I spent the last 10 years at it, not even once. And then some people, in their lives, they say, and I never spent a moment at it. Never spent a moment. And the ego tells them, congratulations, you won the prize. You get to stay in Flatland. All right. So, don't win the booby prize like that. And I know this whole shopping thing, I went through it. I know exactly. It's a severe addiction, actually. But you can get out of it. I've been through the various addictions and stuff and then gotten out of it. I can see, can you get out of this? Because the ego says, no, you can't get out of it. People say, no, I'm too trapped. Nonsense. That's not true. Absolutely, you can get out of it. I wanted to see, is the world really stuck the way it claims it's stuck? No, it's not. It's not. Absolutely not. All you need is to start entering into this mood of repentance, and you will get free of all those addictions. So it's really not like, well, we're so stuck. It's more that we're under this insane assault, a blueprint of imprisonment. And we're not standing up to it in the right way. I know a lot of people are talking about, yeah, the New World Order, You know, the right way to stand up to it is to enter into the mood of repentance, because that's what their real aim is to prevent you from doing. If you're doing what their aim is to prevent you from doing, how are they winning? Think about it that way. How are they winning? They're losing. So like in my life, destiny, they're losing. They're losing. They're being routed. So instead of going on protest marches and, you know, all this intense activity, we've got to defeat these terrible people and stuff, enter into the mood of repentance in your life, and you will find that is what devastates them. That's what causes them to lose. All this activity is exactly what they want. All this protest against them is exactly what they want. Because that pulls you out of the mood of repentance. That's why Jesus said, turn the other cheek. Agree with your adversary. You know, all this stuff. Don't get into a battle with them. That's their whole purpose, is to get you into a battle with them. That's what they want. Because they want you to be pulled away from the mood of repentance so you don't realize your freedom. Freedom is realized from within, not externally. No way. Freedom is the realization that you've never been in prison. There is no flat land, all right? It's an inner realization. It doesn't come from external stuff. No way. Those who work so vigorously to defeat the bad guys, they end up being the next bad guys, the bad girls. Because they have no habits of repentance whatsoever. And so they end up, again, automatically working against that in others. That's how it happens. Meet the new boss, same as the old boss. So, again, There is no other way in your life except to actually do it, to enter into these times where you're just in this mood of repentance, mood of this sober, serious and sober mood. Serious and sober mood where you're not full of action. The action's all taking place in recognition, inner recognition of, hey, wait a minute, what the ego's saying is, maybe if I look at it that way, outside the box this way, let me look it up this way, that way, okay, you know, look, just trying to say, is my perception really, am I really, is it accurate, am I fixed, am I locked, am I imprisoned forever, you know, just looking, quietly, intently, just looking at what the real landscape is, which is the dynamics of perception and belief. These beliefs that we have. Look, examine your belief system. Examining your belief system, examining your valuing of the world, examining the value of what you're perceiving. Is this perception really valuable? Am I really, you know, what is this existence? What is it? What is this birth and aging and death and impermanence? What is this? Just look. And it does require a lot of time. It does require time for sure. So you better start looking, because you're gonna need to do it. There's no other way except to do it. No other way except to do it. There's not gonna be a pill for you. There's not gonna be an app for you. It's a habit. It's simply habits. Good habits are all important. Without good habits, you're not going to succeed. And again, the crisis is a cultural crisis, a spiritual crisis of bad habits in the world. That's the crisis. And the habits in this world are so atrocious, you cannot extrapolate a good outcome from that. You just double down. Get rid of anyone who's not a hedonist, and we'll all be happy. Because the hedonists say, you know, I'm not happy because those people over there, they're not partying with me. So that's why I'm not happy. So, hey, come on, you got to party too. You don't want to? Oh, well, you know, get rid of you then. Get rid of you. Easily, hedonism easily turns into extraordinarily bad movements of attack. These people are ruining our party. You know how people are partying? You know how disputes arise? So many disputes. If someone's having a party at their house and someone next door says, hey, you know, hey, knock it off. You're too loud. You're too this. You're too that. And then arguments happen. Fights break out. You know, and people, hey, those guys want to stop our party. What? And the rowdiness arises, you know. And before you know it, there's shootings. There's all sorts of problems that happen at those situations. On a mass scale, you have this massive hedonistic movement. Like Nazism was really a hedonistic movement, actually, from the Weimar Republic, from Berlin, with very decadent hedonistic times, actually, in those places. Cult of the body and all this stuff. And they felt, hey, you know, the rest of the world is holding us back, you know. We're like ready to be this super, super happy, you know, hedonistic, naturalistic, secular materialistic people. And the rest of the world, they're ruining our party. We gotta, you know, shape them up. We gotta shape them up. We got too many sober, serious people who are not with the program, the new program. And so they were so enthused. They were so, you know, morphed into, let's attack the rot. You know, let's get rid of the rot in the world. What's holding us back? What's holding the world back from this secular materialist utopia? You know, and who's in our space? We want party space. We want living space. We want space to, you know, recreate. We want all this stuff. And so it gets out of hand very fast. If anyone's been in a party and they realize how easy it is for it to all get out of hand. Whereas if people in a mood of repentance, there's it doesn't get out of hand at all. All I need is just this one little seat. That's all I need, you know, as far as space in the world, that's all I really need. It's just somewhere to sit, and that's it. So how can you be expansionist? How can you be warlike? I don't know. I just need to sit quietly. And a little place to sleep. A little place to sleep, a little place to sit. Yeah. See, that's how world peace comes about. That's how it comes about. And we're not headed in that direction. So the only thing to do is to turn it around is for you to actually, the change starts in the mirror with us. The change starts with us actually doing it, actually doing it. We should not try to bring about an effect in the world at all. It just, whatever effect happens. We just have to be focused on this mood of repentance, seeing, wow, I've been hallucinating. There's no flatness at all. Get to that point. Keep moving towards that point. I can change my perception. My perception is not set. It can be changed. Get to that point. I can see this vision of pure of spaciousness in all things. I can see that, you know. And so just keep going towards that. And don't worry about all the materialism too much. It's easy to get in, it gets into you easily. Just all the food, all the stuff that's available, you know, it gets into you. But you gotta be very careful not to let it get you. How do you do that? Keep practicing. That's it. There's no secret. You just do it. You just have to do it. If you need to, read a book or read a little bit or something to trigger this sobriety. Keep triggering your sobriety. Keep triggering your sobriety. All right. So we've done some here. We've done some here. I need to do some more today. There's no question about it. Very, very serious. It's like, wow, I can see my freedom is right there. That's a serious thing, isn't it? Because the alternative is not very good. It's not very good. All right. Very great. We'll end on that note.